both groundbreaking and entrenched. The direct and indirect messages of Franklin. The visual kinship that Franklin possesses with Pig Pen complicates and even undercuts his reputation as a progressive character. The shared shading technique for these two figures connects them in ways that seriously compromise and even wholly contradict Schultz's intended activism. The cartoonist introduced a black character to his comic strip with the intention of fostering compassion, encouraging empathy, and generating understanding. The visual elements that link Franklin to Pigpen have the opposite effect. Instead of helping to break down racial enmity, they work to maintain it. Even if only on an unconscious level, presenting Franklin in this manner reaffirms long-standing ways in which blackness has been stigmatized and black people have been denigrated. In so doing, Schultz's inclusion of Franklin ironically reinforces some of the same harmful attitudes about race that he was created to combat. To be clear, no evidence suggests that Charles M. Schultz presented Franklin's blackness in this manner to deliberately deride it or symbolically denigrate it. Again, the cartoonist was trying to engage in activism that would be progressive and would advance the cause of racial justice, equity, and civil rights. In fact, Schultz may have employed the line-hatching technique to indicate that Franklin is African-American because he was following the example of another black cartoonist. From the origins of American cartoon art in the 19th century, non-white characters had been presented, both in the plots to comics and in their visual depiction on the page, in highly stereotypical ways. As Frances Gateward and John Jennings have discussed, quote, "The first images of black people in comics were loosely based on the stereotypes generated in blackface minstrelsy," end quote. Beginning with the black youngsters who appeared in the background of Richard F. Outcault's The Yellow Kid during the 1890s, continuing with named characters such as Ebony White, from Will Eisner's popular newspaper strip The Spirit during the 1940s, and extending through secondary sidekicks such as Jackson and Dennis the Menace in 1970, African-American figures were depicted as comedic buffoons who more closely resembled simians than humans. Whether male or female, adult or child, these characters had dark black skin, big white eyes, and thick red lips. They were merely stock racist caricatures, not realistic individuals. Given this situation, Rebecca Wanzo has noted, quote, "Racist caricature was thus not a side note to U.S. cartooning's emergence. It was central to it," end quote. Maury Turner, in his landmark newspaper strip We Pals, sought to change this trend. Making its debut on the 15th of February 1965, the comic was the first to feature a racially and ethnically diverse cast of young characters, Howard 16. Just as significantly, it also presented these individuals in ways that did not traffic in long-standing aesthetic stereotypes. Turner, for example, used line hatching rather than dark shading, to indicate that Nipper was African-American. Charles M. Schultz was not only familiar with We Pals, he knew Maury Turner professionally. As Martha Ross reported, the black cartoonist, quote, "admired Schultz's peanuts and mold creating a black Charlie Brown," end quote. Schultz encouraged him to do so. Quote, "he ran with that," end quote, recalled David Bellard, a family friend. We Pals was the end product of that process. When Schultz introduced an African-American character to Peanuts in 1968, he may have employed line hatching to signal Franklin's race because of Turner's We Pals. The white cartoonist might have been following the lead of his black colleague for how to depict African-American characters in a more appropriate, non-biased, and non-racist way. However, the fact that Schultz had already long employed the same aesthetic feature in Peanuts to signal Dirt complicated and even nullified that objective. This situation offers a powerful illustration of the gap that can occur between people's intentions and their actual impact. While Schultz's intentions were to combat racist stereotypes, his actions actually had the opposite effect. They perpetuated them, however, unwittingly. Moreover, the ramifications of his actions extend far beyond this one individual. The way in which Schultz unconsciously, unintentionally, or accidentally drew his new black character in a manner that mirrored his dirty white character also exemplifies the insidiousness of racism. Disparaging attitudes about race become ingrained. By becoming ingrained, they become normalized, and by becoming normalized, they are perpetuated. Schultz did not notice that he used the same shading technique for Franklin's blackness as he did for Pigpen's dirtiness, or the often uncannily similar way that the two figures looked as a result. These features likewise cause readers of the strip, especially white ones, to associate Franklin's blackness with Pigpen's dirtiness, however unconsciously. When Harriet Glickman first contacted Schultz about adding a black character to Peanuts, she was acutely aware of the power that this media wielded. As she explained in her initial letter, newspaper comics, quote, are of tremendous importance in shaping the unconscious attitudes of our kids, end quote. The messages that popular strips like Peanuts send, both directly and indirectly, explicitly or implicitly, influence adult and especially child readers in ways of which they might not be entirely aware. The widespread public recognition of Franklin further underscores the gravity of this situation. As Christopher P. Lehman has written, quote, by 1973, Charles M. Schultz had developed one of the most durable and widely seen African-American comic strip characters in the history of the industry, end quote. Of course, Franklin was not the only black character to appear in American newspaper comics during this era. The late 1960s and early 1970s saw the release of several new strips that not only featured black child characters, but were penned by black cartoonists. As mentioned earlier, in 1965, Maury Turner's Wee Pals made its debut. Showcasing a group of kids known as the Rainbow Gang, the strip featured male and female youngsters who hailed from a diverse array of racial and ethnic backgrounds: black, white, Chicano, Native American, Asian, and Jewish. 3 years later, in 1968, the same year that Schultz added Franklin to Peanuts, another comic featuring young black protagonists appeared, Luther. Created and drawn by Brumzik Brandon Jr., the strip ran until 1986 and presented some of the most pointed sociopolitical commentary in the history of American comics. Finally, but far from insignificantly, in 1970, Ted Shearer's strip Quincy began its 16-year run. The comic chronicled the experiences of the title character, a young black boy about 9 years old who is being raised by his grandmother in Harlem. Although the strip had a clear protagonist, it featured a diverse array of characters: classmates whom Quincy meets at school, children who live in his neighborhood, and friends of his grandmother. Given these titles, newspaper readers in the United States had a choice of several strips featuring non-white characters. However, none matched the popularity of Peanuts and thus the visibility of Franklin. From the mid-1960s through the early 1970s, Schultz's newspaper strip reached the apex of its success. Indeed, it is difficult to overestimate the commercial popularity as well as the cultural power of Peanuts during this period. As Chip Kidd has reported, quote, the comic strip ran in over 2,600 newspapers, with a readership of 355 million in 75 countries, translated into 21 languages, end quote. As a result, Franklin was seen by far more Americans, especially white Americans, than Luther, Quincy, or the characters from Wee Pals. Not only did Franklin appear in a strip that was exceedingly popular, but he was also one of the few black characters on the comics page. In 1988, quote, the Detroit Free Press counted the number of characters in its comic pages in a given month and came up with 5,250 whites and 31 blacks, 0.6%, end quote. The statistics in 2004, 4 years after Schultz's death and the official end of Peanuts, were not much better. In the opening years of the 21st century, quote, 96% of comics characters were white, and only 2.5% were black, end quote. Given this context, the messages that Schultz's character conveyed about race, both directly and indirectly, consciously and unconsciously, intentionally and inadvertently, wielded tremendous sociopolitical power. Franklin helped to shape popular attitudes about black people in ways that audiences may not have been fully realized.